तो स्किन एंड एलर्जी विशाखापट्टनम सर हैज ट्रेन वर्क इन यूके फॉर मोर देन 10 इयर्स विथ 2 इयर्स मोर सर्जरी ट्रेनिंग एंड 2 इयर्स ऑफ डर्म फेलोशिप सर इज डिप्लोमा इन डर्मेटोपैथोलॉजी फ्रॉम फ्रैंकफर्ट एंड हैज मोर देन 30 पब्लिकेशंस इन वेरियस इंटरनेशनल पीयर रिव्यूड जर्नल्स सर इज सेक्शन एडिटर IJDVL एंड सर स्पेशल इंटरेस्ट आर इन पिगमेंट्री disorders, dermatopathology, and cutaneous surgery. Currently, he is the secretary, North Andhra Association of Dermatologists, Venereologists, and Leprologists. Welcome.
Thank you very much. At the outset, I'd like to thank the Gujarat IADDL and the SIG Dermatopathology for giving me this opportunity to speak at this. Without much delay, I'm going to start off. I'll just have to move the controls. Right. So this is my current pet topic, actually, acneiform eruptions on seborrheic areas. Now, over the last few years, especially in this part of the world, I've been seeing a number of cases of acneiform eruptions on the trunk area and the face. And a number of differentials normally cross our mind when we are seeing cases like this. So the differential diagnosis for acneiform eruptions on seborrheic areas include, apart from acne, pterosporum folliculitis, keratosis pilaris, eruptive milia, lichen planopilaris, eruptive vellus hair cysts, and steatocystoma multiplex. Now, these are all overlapping entities, and I, for one, find it extremely difficult clinically to differentiate these entities, especially when you don't have typical acne lesions on the face to say that, okay, this is just bund or truncal acne. So now, before I go into in discussing how I approach this, I would like to describe a few entities that are not so known to us as dermatopathologists or even dermatologists, so that we can understand these better and then see how we can evaluate these entities better. So firstly, what are milia? We think we know milia, but there is a lot to be learned. Milia are small cysts, but actually believed to be tumors, lined by several layers of stratified squamous epithelium with central keratinous material resembling a small epidermoid cyst. So essentially, if you look at a milium, it looks like a small epidermoid cyst. However, it differs in the sense that it is not connected to the surface epithelium. And though epidermoid cyst does not have hairs within its cavity, it may have sometimes, and milia never has hairs within the cyst cavity. Believe it or not, the pathogenesis of milia and benign skin tumors of the skin has been elucidated by Epstein and Kligman way back in 1956. But none of this data has actually gone into standard textbooks. I wonder why. They said that the epidermis and all of its appendageal derivatives were seen to be capable of putting forth strands and cords of undifferentiated or indifferent cells, which had the potentiality of giving rise to milia. Now, remember this epidermis and all its appendageal derivatives. It's not just the hair follicle. It's not just the epidermis. It's not just the eccrine duct. Anything can give rise to milia. And how did they come to this conclusion? They did studies. They did studies on naturally occurring facial milia, EB milia that we commonly see. And they found that naturally occurring facial milia are derived from the infundibulum, the outer root sheath of the hair follicle near the infundibulum. They basically, the infundibulum forms a small cyst which gets blocked off at the top and the bottom, and you have a cyst which basically is lying freely in the papillary dermis. EB milia, on the other hand, are derived from eccrine ducts. So in the process of scarring, the eccrine duct gets cut off from the superficial epidermis, and because it has to empty somewhere, it just coils upon itself and forms a small cyst. And that is what is an EB milium. And you can see the attachment to an eccrine duct below this. Some milia are derived directly from the epidermis, and they've proved this by doing autotransplant experiments. So especially acral milia, which are caused when you, with needle pricks, etc., can just derive from the epidermis, where the epidermis just folds upon itself, forming a small cyst. Then you have milia derived from the sebaceous duct. And this is particularly prominent in milium following dermabrasion, wherein if the dermabrasion is deep enough, and cuts off the sebaceous duct from the lining, from the attachment to the hair follicle, then after what happens is that the sebaceous duct, because it cannot empty itself either into the hair follicle nor reach the epidermis, it closes upon itself, forming a small milial cyst. Okay, so these are milia derived from the sebaceous duct. Okay, now the more common comedones, what are these? Comedones, as we know, are precursors for acne. They are a consequence of abnormal hyperkeratinization and reduced desquamation of the follicular epithelium near the infundibulum, actually, followed by subsequent dilatation of the follicle underneath, which eventually leads to a cyst-like cavity within the infundibulum filled with a compact mass of keratinous material, sebaceous material, and numerous bacteria. And this is a typical example of a comedone. However, if you look at the other cysts here beside the one in the middle, these could be easily confused for milia. And this often happens, I tell you, and clinically also we see that patients with number of comedones on the face often do have milia in between. So milia are basically comedone-like cysts, but not necessarily derived from the infundibulum always, but they do so when they are on the face. They're derived from the infundibulum, just like comedones, but they're cut off both from the surface and from underneath. Okay, right. One more important thing to remember is that comedones, but not milia, undergo cycling. So depending on the age of the comedones, numerous vellus hair shafts may be found. What do I mean by cycling? I mean the hair cycle continues. So because the hairs continue to put the root continues to produce new vellus hair shafts, and there is a blockage on the top, there is an outlet obstruction. So these hair shafts get emptied into this comedonal cyst, leading to retention of these vellus hair shafts. Now, this is not commonly reported in textbooks. Closed comedones are supposed to have about one or two hair shafts within them, but open comedones may have up to 10 to 15 hairs in the lumen. And this is a well-known fact. Right, so what are epidermoid cysts? Well, as I told you, they resemble both milia and comedones, but more so comedones. The lining of the both arise from the follicular infundibulum, and both have an identical epithelial lining. And like comedones, they demonstrate an epithelial connection. Though it is rare, hair shafts can be seen within the lumen. But the difference is that these epidermoid cysts are larger and deeper. And once they enlarge, once these comedonal cysts enlarge and become deep and dermal, they destroy the underlying hair follicle. The underlying hair root gets either regresses or gets destroyed, and therefore they don't have an attachment to an underlying hair follicle. But the attachment to the epidermis usually is retained. Now, having discussed comedones, milium, and infundibular cysts, I have to put it out, but that there is a lot of confusion even in standard dermatology textbooks and in research articles. This is an article, excellent article by Cunliffe et al. On comedone formation etiology. And they've put forth this picture showing a microcomedone, which is the one on the left, I'm presuming here, which is a small early comedone. Now look at this picture of a cyst in the deep dermis. Now this is the epidermis here on the left-hand side. It's not, the section is not oriented properly in their figure. But you can see this cyst lying in the deep dermis, more like an infundibular cyst, but it's a small one. Would you call this a milium? Would you call this a comedone? I don't know. And look at this paper by Suji in 1975, where he described an incomplete milium. So in milia, derived from the epidermis, this is not from the hair follicle infundibulum, this is from the epidermis. While it is closing, before it completely closes, it has a connection to the epidermis. So, and this is what they call an incomplete milium. This is slightly different from a comedone, but as I said, I believe that comedones may also sometimes turn into milia if their opening gets completely blocked off at the top. All right. Now, talking about multiple hair shafts, the commonest disease we see with multiple hair shafts within one infundibulum is trichostasis spinulosa, these comedonal-like lesions on the nose. Now, exactly the same mechanism here. But what happens here is because of reduced desquamation and the keratin, you see the stratum corneum here, tightens like a noose around the hair shafts. And the hair shafts are caught in a vice-like grip and cannot be extruded out. Normally hair shafts, once their cycle is over, fall off. But this is not the case in trichostasis spinulosa. The hair follicle underneath continues to produce hair follicles, which are stuck at the surface. And this is what trichostasis spinulosa is. There is only one hair matrix and papilla at the base of the follicle, in contrast to Pilei multigeminae. Okay? But look at this. Look at this. This is a case report from one of our own, published in the International Journal of Trichology. And they've published this as trichostasis spinulosa, presenting as itchy papules, and this is somewhere around the ear. These do not look like trichostasis spinulosa, I have to say. They are infundibular cysts, quite deep in the dermis with a lichenoid reaction. This is not trichostasis spinulosa by any means. Look at this. This is a picture of Nevus comedonicus from Mackey's textbook of pathology. Now, yes, this is a comedone. But what about this? This is a huge, deep cyst in the deep dermis. This is an infundibular cyst. This is not a comedone. And look at this. This is a milial cyst. This is not a comedone. There's no overlying connection to the epidermis. This is a milial cyst. How is it different from a milial cyst, these small ones? This is a comedone, I agree. But what about these? There is a lot of confusion. All right, I'll just give a brief mention about pterosporum folliculitis. Now, pterosporum folliculitis often occurs in the context of acne on seborrheic areas, and the initiating event is like acne. There is distension of an occluded hair follicle in infundibula, leading to basophilic keratinous debris containing clusters of round budding yeast cells, Malassezia, wherein in acne you just have bacteria. And often, because of the inflammatory reaction against pterosporum, you have a suppurative or granulomatous inflammatory infiltrate, though sometimes in early cases it can be mononuclear. And this is an example of pterosporum folliculitis. Right, what about steatocystoma? This is a tumor of the pilosebaceous duct, typically has a collapsed cyst wall, lined by stratified squamous epithelium, pretty much like an infundibular cyst, but then there is no granular layer because the sebaceous duct does not have a granular layer. And the most important feature is that it has a crenulated inner border. I'll explain that in a second, lined by a thick homogeneous eosinophilic cuticle. Now, it was believed that the finding of sebaceous lobules in or adjacent to the cyst wall is characteristic and typical, and that's how you diagnose steatocystoma. However, that is not the case. There are a number of cases where sebaceous glands are not found, and these are now called sebaceous duct cysts or keratocysts. It does not matter. They are all derived from the sebaceous duct. And if you're seeing this typical crenulated inner border with an eosinophilic cuticle, with or without a sebaceous gland, as in here, this is a sebaceous duct cyst or a steatocystoma, whatever you want to call it. All right. Now, to confuse you all, we've got something called an eruptive vellus hair cyst. This was first reported in 1977 by the Pincus group as an unusual developmental abnormality of the vellus hair follicle, predisposing them to occlusion at the level of the infundibulum. The story repeats itself. In all these entities I've described, there is occlusion at the level of the infundibulum. What is new? Resulting in retention of hair. Again, what is new? Causing cystic dilatation of the proximal part of the follicle. What is new? Causing secondary atrophy of the hair bulbs. Of course, if the cyst becomes large enough, the hair bulb becomes atrophic secondarily or gets destroyed by the inflammation. Well, there is nothing new in this. However, this is described as an entity and presents as multiple small asymptomatic acneiform comedonal papules with a prediction for the chest and axillary. And this is a typical clinical or the histological picture, and it is no different from the others I'm going to show you in a second. Where you see here, you're seeing multiple hair shafts within an infundibular cyst. All right. In a systematic review of 178 cases in this group, they found hair bulbs attached to the cyst wall in about 20% of cases, a connection to the overlying epidermis in 8%, sebaceous lobules with the cyst wall, like a steatocystoma, in about 4%, and even pilar muscle attached to the outer cyst wall in about 2-3% of cases. Right. So, a number of authors have subsequently found an association between EVHC and steatocystoma multiplex, wherein they found both lesions presenting together in the same patient, and they called it multiple pilosebaceous cysts. And some authors have said that in addition to steatocystoma, persistent infantile milia and epidermoid cysts and EVHC are extremes of the same spectrum. The level of the sebaceous duct where the cyst originates determines its presentation. And then you also have hybrid cysts to complicate it all, wherein within the same cyst, you have combinations of EVHC, steatocystoma, epidermoid cyst, etc. And you name a few, a trichelemal cyst has been associated. This diagram summarizes and explains the entire pathogenesis. Okay, so this is the hair follicle. This is the hair. This is the hair shaft that you're seeing. This is the infundibulum. The portion where the sebaceous gland attaches is the infundibular ischemic region. Below the sebaceous gland attachment, up to the attachment of the erectorous pylorum muscle, is the isthmus. Now, blockage of the apparatus here leads to either milia or comedones. If it continues to cycle, you might find hair shafts within the cyst. Whether you want to call it eruptive vellus hair cyst or a comedonal cyst is up to you. If there is a blockage here, this causes the infundibular ischemic type of eruptive vellus hair cyst. It's not really an eruptive vellus hair cyst, it's just a hair follicle cyst. And then this is the ischemic type. If the blockage occurs here, now because the blockage occurs here, the hair follicle root is not affected, hair continues to cycle, and therefore within the cyst, you're going to continue to see hair follicle shafts. And this is where you see steatocystocytoma, steatocystoma with multiple vellus hair follicles. It is not an eruptive vellus hair cyst. It is just steatocystocytoma with retention hair follicles. If the blockage occurs here, you see a sebaceous duct cyst. Now, because this has no connection to the hair shaft, this breaks off, forming a steatocystocytoma, and they don't find hair follicles within it if the cyst is arising here. All right, I have to mention lichen planus follicularis tumidus, which is another controversial entity, described as white to yellow milia-like cysts and comedones on a violaceous hyperpigmented plaque, commonly involving the retroauricular area, clinically resembling milia on plaque. This is from a journal, and you see milia-like lesions on a hyperpigmented base. Histologically, you see lots of milial cysts or infundibular cysts, whatever you want to call them, with lichenoid inflammation. Now, this is a hugely controversial entity. There are two cases of lichen planus follicular lichen planus, which have got intense inflammation. And when lichen planus secondarily results in milia, you can call this lichen planus follicularis tumidus. However, in my opinion, these are simply milial cysts with secondary lichenoid inflammation. This is not lichen planus follicularis tumidus, though this is the original description. So follicular LP itself can cause secondary milia. Or are these milia with secondary lichenoid inflammation? Both exist. I think the true name, if you want to truly call something lichen planus follicularis tumidus, it has to be follicular LP causing secondary milia, not the other way around as in this case. In fact, lichenoid inflammation is underdescribed, but underreported, but is very common in cutaneous cysts, extremely common in clinical practice if you look about, and as a consequence either of cyst rupture or de novo, without even cyst rupture, it can be a foreign body reaction of the body against the cyst wall in the dermis. With this in mind, I'm going to show you a few cases to illustrate what we've just discussed. Case one is a 45-year-old female with a 7-month history of itchy papular lesions behind the left ear. Histologically, you're seeing collapsed cysts. I told you steatocystoma usually has collapsed cysts, and that's what these look like. And then look at this, the multiple hair shafts, and also you can see primitive hair germ here. So this is, you can understand why, where the hairs are coming from. So this is what you call an eruptive vellus hair cyst, but this is what I called it when I first came across this condition, and I'm not going to call this anymore because I know what it is, and I'll explain what I would call these entities at the end in my summary. Now look at this other cyst. This has not got any eruptive hairs within it. This has not got any vellus hairs. Okay, it's just that the level of occlusion within the sebaceous duct is slightly different. This is within the sebaceous duct, not within the isthmic infundibular region. And therefore, you do not see hair shafts within the cyst. This is the same section. And you're seeing a lichenoid infiltrate. And this is a foreign body reaction. The cyst has not ruptured. Oh, sorry, this is not a foreign body reaction. This is just to cyst rupture. This is just the body reacting against the cyst wall. The contents have not ruptured out. Case two is a patient with a 5-year history of progressing soft lesions on the anterior neck and shoulders. Clinically, steatocystoma. Histologically, you're seeing a nice sebaceous gland attached to the cyst wall, consistent with steatocystoma. Look at the cavity. You have this granular debris. This is called sebolemal material. This is not keratin, in contrast to infundibular cysts. You don't find keratin in steatocystoma. You find this granular sebolemal material. And look at these. These are all empty hair shafts. These are hair shafts which are old, and you can see them here. This is not an eruptive vellus hair cyst again. These are just keratocystoma with retained hair follicles. And you can see the eosinophilic crenulated lining and hair shafts within it. Case three, 27-year-old male with comedonal lesions of forehead for 2 to 3 years, unresponsive to topical and systemic retinoids. All right, typical steatocystoma, histologically, lots of multiple hair shafts and sebo-lemmal material, no keratin, okay? Unusual presentation, isn't it? Case four, 35-year-old male with a 2-year history of multiple itchy comedonal papules, no true comedones, with occasional lesions on the scalp and groins. What does this show you? So this case is pretty much similar to the previous case I just presented, but then histologically they're different. The previous one was a steatocystoma. This one has got a microcomedone with lichenoid inflammation in this section. This is a microcomedone wherein the comedone is still about to form. You see a dilated infant bloom, but no comedone yet. It's not a cyst yet. And then you do deeper levels. And when you do deeper levels, you're seeing a true comedonal cyst here, again with lichenoid inflammation. Okay, so is this acne? Something else? We'll have to leave it to the discussion. Case five, 23-year-old male with steroid-induced acneiform lesions in the trunk, but not responding to benzoyl peroxide and doxycycline. Typical comedone, two comedones joining up together. Look at the intense lichenoid inflammation. And then if you go deeper, you're also going to see a cyst has ruptured, the comedonal cyst has ruptured, leading to a granulomatous foreign body reaction around the hair shaft. Case six, 14-year-old male with 2-year history of extensive papular rash and trunk and arms, itching on exposure to heat. Look at this. Pterosporum folliculitis, is it? Or is it acne? Something else? Histologically, comedonal cyst. Again, look at the lichenoid inflammation around the cyst. Can you see that? The cyst wall, there is lichenoid inflammation around the cyst wall. And this is keratinous, non-sebo-lemmal material, granular layer within the infundibular wall. So this is not a steatocystoma. This is infundibular comedonal cyst with lichenoid inflammation. Case seven, similar patient, but then not healing and multiple lesions, progressive healing with post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. In this case, similar to the previous case, but now you're seeing the underlying retained hair follicle and the hair root, but this is also about to get destroyed. You can see this you can see the pathogenesis live here. Isn't this exciting? And you can see that because the hair follicle is still alive, it is producing hair follicles. And then you can see the retained hair shafts within the cyst cavity. And then the lichenoid inflammation eventually will destroy the bottom layer, leading to what may just be a comedone with hair shafts, and then that may be destroyed eventually as well. Case eight, a patient with an itchy rash on the trunk, pigmentation, loss of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation with small pustules interspersed in between. Again, you're seeing a comedonal cyst, but can you make out these round oval structures? A clue to the diagnosis. And deeper levels, you find a marked spongiotic dermatitis. And then you find these on PA stain. This is pterosporum folliculitis. Now, the question again I ask, is this pterosporum colonization causing secondary inflammation in a seborrheic area that is acne prone? Or is pterosporum primarily responsible for this entire pathogenesis? As I told you, the primary pathogenesis of pterosporum folliculitis again is occlusion of the hair follicle just like acne. So the common features between these cases I discussed is A, origin from the pilosebaceous unit, B, distribution along the head and neck and trunk and arms where the concentration of pilosebaceous units is the highest. They may or may not have an interface lichenoid dermatitis, and they may or may not have numerous hair shafts within the cyst cavity. So the question that begs is eruptive vellus hair cyst a disease or a phenomenon? It is definitely a phenomenon from my reading, experience and understanding. It is simply an epiphenomenon wherein in milia, comedones, or epidermoid cysts or steatocystoma, if any of these conditions leads to occlusion of the outlet and the hair cycling continues, it leads to production of multiple vellus hairs which are retained within the cyst cavity. Milia, comedones, epidermoid cysts, and steatocystoma are all related conditions arising from the pilosebaceous unit, the development of which depends simply on the site of origin of the cyst and lesion and how large it eventually becomes and whether it causes subsequent destruction of the underlying hair follicle. So what is my diagnosis for these cases? I'm finishing, just 1 second. Yes. So my final diagnosis or my final approach to these entities is to simply call them multiple pilosebaceous cysts. And I would like to describe their lining as being infundibular, isthmic, or sebaceous, as Ackerman suggested we do with all these cysts. They may or may not have multiple hair shafts, which is an epiphenomenon. They may or may not have malassezia or pyrosporum, which, if present, needs treatment appropriately. And they may or may not have lichen node inflammation, if which is intense, needs anti-inflammatories. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the engrossing session. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Rita Vora, ma'am, to present her talk on histopathology of leprosy. Ma'am is professor and ex-head Department of Skin and BD, Pramukhswami Medical College and Shri Krishna Hospital, Karamsad. Ma'am is an experienced working as a professor and head for the last 28 years. She has regularly attended international and national level conferences. Ma'am has delivered lectures and chaired sessions.
No need to read all the things. It's okay.
Okay.
Can I start?
Sure, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, Rasmi, and all of the people. As such,